After the fall of the Shah, Khomeini and his followers inherited Iran. Quickly, they began dismantling and erasing the Shah's images, demolishing the late tomb of his father Reza Shah and rebranding Iran as an Islamic Republic. Saudi Arabia experienced its own unrest the same year the Iranian Revolution concluded. Protests amongst the Shia population in the eastern province was rising. While in the west of the country, the re-emergence of the self-styled Ikhwan, an attempted revival of their previous iteration, shook the country. Hello everyone, and welcome back to the second video of our three-part series on the history of Saudi Arabia and Iran. Juhayman, a grandson of Ikhwan leader Sultan Ibn Bajad Al-Otaibi, whom the late King Abdulaziz defeated during the rebellion, led the newly formed rebels. Juhayman then seized Masjid al-Haram in Mecca, took hostages, and proclaimed his brother-in-law Muhammad al-Qahtani the Mahdi. After 2 weeks of intense clashes between Saudi security forces and the rebels, the mosque was stormed with the help of French commandos. Juhayman and his followers were arrested. Over the following months, Juhayman and what remained of the newly rebirthed Ikhwan were publicly executed. Unsuccessful in their goals, their actions spread panic across Saudi Arabia that echoed within the royal family itself. Religious unrest was rising from both the Salafi ulama and the Shia minority. In response to dissatisfaction amongst clerics, King Khalid decided the best way to fight religious extremism is by using more religion. He sought to quell religious dissatisfaction amongst the Salafi sheikhs by increasing their powers over society, while also releasing Shia political prisoners who were previously arrested, before embarking on a public tour of their towns and villages in the east. The revolution in Iran had disrupting consequences for Saudi Arabia. Seeing the rise and the success of the Islamic Revolution in toppling the Shah, uneased Al Saud. The Saudis viewed Ayatollah Khomeini as an instant practical threat to monarchies in the region. Not only did he threaten the security of the Gulf states and its Arab neighbors with his ideology of exporting the revolution through their Shia populations, his system of governance claimed divine right to rule, which directly threatened the claim to Mecca and Medina. At the time, Al-Saud enjoyed local religious legitimacy and popular backing through a historical alliance with the Al-Sheikh family, originating in the 18th century. The descendants of Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab legitimized Saudi rulers amongst the conservatives. Al-Saud promoted and engaged with clerics that supported them and helped administer their societal affairs. In contrast, Khomeini, with the philosophy of Walayat al-Faqih, or guardianship of the jurist, meant the religious class answered to no one. It was their divine right to rule the land. The democracy that Khomeini envisioned meant that democratic candidates and their results were his to bless and approve. Although King Khalid congratulated Khomeini for his successful revolution, Khomeini began publicly questioning the relationship of the Saudis to the West, their commitment to Islam, and the ruling legitimacy of the monarchy. He saw Al Saud and the clerics in Saudi as heretics, further popularizing the old British and Ottoman label of calling the Saudis and their religious establishment Wahhabis, a term considered religiously derogatory by Saudis and their Salafi populace. Soon, with Saudi, Kuwaiti, and US support, Iraqi President Saddam, with the presumption of Iran's weak security situation after the revolution, invaded his neighbor, seeking to annex what he saw as an Arab province, Khuzestan. Iraqi men began to march to Iran. The war led to Iran harassing and striking Gulf merchant vessels throughout the war. Khomeini, mirroring his experience with the Shah, was a staunch anti-monarchist. He saw the Gulf countries as Western outposts. Sermon after sermon, he attacked his Gulf neighbors, seeking to gain influence with the Shias of Iraq and the wider Gulf. In one sermon, Khomeini once said, "Even if it were possible to forgive Saddam Hussein, it would never be possible to forgive Saudi Arabia. These vile and ungodly Wahhabis are like daggers which have always pierced the heart of the Muslims from the back. Mecca is in the hand of a band of heretics." The Iranian Revolutionary Guard, tasked with protecting and exporting the revolution, was chiefly responsible for Iran's covert actions around the region. Iran's bid for influence was a strategy of setting up networks of revolutionary cells in other Middle Eastern nations, funding them and directly controlling them in some cases. Some of these include the Tehran 8 in Afghanistan, Badr Brigade in Iraq, Hezbollah in Lebanon, Islamic Front for Liberation of Bahrain, and in Saudi Arabia, Hezbollah fil Hijaz. In contrast, the Saudis relied on a decentralized funding of individuals who formed their own grassroots organizations and militias to fight perceived threats. Much of the funding was done in close cooperation with other Gulf allies and the West. The focus and the policy at the time was mainly to push back against communism in the region. One of these Islamist and anti-communist groups were Maktab al-Khadamat, set up to recruit foreign mujahideen to fight in Afghanistan, chiefly led by Osama bin Laden. The Iranians and the Saudis began to spread their opposing influence, having stakes in the Lebanese Civil War and Soviet-Afghan War. Although armed struggle was the mode in many conflict areas, religious pilgrimages were not spared. Before Khomeini's ascension to rule in 1971, he encouraged demonstrations amongst his followers during Hajj, calling these demonstrations distancing ourselves from mushrikeen. Khomeini sought to encourage his followers to spread political messages when performing their pilgrimage. At first, these protests were generally anti-American and anti-Israeli. The Saudis were largely apathetic to the political messages. But the mood changed after the revolution. As Khomeini became actively hostile to the Saudi royal family and the state, the Saudis began limiting these protests and making it difficult for Khomeini-aligned pilgrims to gather for a demonstration. The Saudis took the stance that they did not want to politicize the Hajj, especially if it were to become a case between Muslims. In response, during the mid-1980s, Khomeini instructed the pilgrims not to distribute printed political material and to aim their criticism against non-Muslim governments. The Saudis responded by allowing two demonstrations, one in Mecca and the other in Medina. Towards the end of Khomeini's reign, during the annual Hajj of 1987, things took a turn for the worst. Iran argued that a march or demonstration outside was too far from Al-Haram Mosque and would not be enough, and demanded the Saudis to allow the demonstrations into the mosque. After strict negotiation, the Saudis agreed to allow demonstrators to protest half a kilometer away from the mosque, and then allowing them to join other pilgrims in the mosque after. The Saudis put their security forces at high alert. As the demonstration was ending, it's alleged that some demonstrators encouraged Iranian pilgrims to move together and continue demonstrating into the mosque. They found their route blocked by Saudi police. This led to huge clashes between demonstrators and the Saudi security forces. The clashes led to over 400 dead, over 200 Iranians, 85 Saudis, many of them policemen, and 45 other nationalities that found themselves caught between the chaos. Blame for the tragedy was thrown on each side, with Saudis claiming policemen were attacked by clubs and knives as they blocked the route to the mosque, and the police blocking the mosque route was due to claims that they were continuing their demonstration. While the Iranians claimed there was no provocation, and that the Saudis began firing at protesters as they tried to disperse, Saudi claimed there was no single bullet fired, accusing some Iranian pilgrims of bringing knives and clubs with them under their cloaks. Hajj for Iranian pilgrims was banned by their own government for the next 3 years. At the back of an all-time heightened tension between Saudi and Iran, Saudi and its Gulf neighbors formed the Gulf Cooperation Council, GCC, to cooperate closer in response to Iran and the rise of Saddam. Meanwhile, as Iraq failed to gain its objectives and the war soon ended, Saddam was highly indebted to the Gulf. Feeling a more insecure position at home, he secluded himself by refusing to pay back loans granted by his neighbors, resulting in his invasion of Kuwait. Saddam's short-lived conquest was undone by an American-led coalition with the GCC. Meanwhile, with the death of Khomeini, the revolutionary threat took a backseat. Once an ally, Saddam was the main focus of Saudi and GCC foreign policy. Iran now sought to mend ties with the Gulf to oppose their mutual threat in Baghdad, and warming with Saudi Arabia came rapidly, following an invite by King Fahad for Iran's new president, Rafsanjani, to Hajj. King Fahad seemed to be extending an arm to Iran, proclaiming in a speech,
"What does Iran want from all that is happening? Iran has harmed relations not only with us, but also with its neighbors in the whole world. Iran has attacked Kuwait and the UAE and struck at our merchant ships. Who benefits from this? Why undermine peace in the region while it's possible to attain coexistence and spare Muslims' blood and money? We want reason and logic to triumph so that peace will prevail in the region. We want the moderate minds to play their role in Iran.
He later continued,
"At our end, we stopped media campaigns against Iran. Iran has all that can enable it to live in peace without interfering in others' internal affairs. We want good relations with everyone."
Heir to the throne, Prince Abdullah invited the Iranian president to visit Riyadh and attended the first OIC meeting in Tehran, famously posing in photos with Iranian diplomats. And although the US implicated Iran in the Khobar bombings in 1996, the countries began cooperating economically, and the Saudis even sided with the Iranians in their disputes against the Taliban in Afghanistan. And in 1998, Iran's President Khatami visited Riyadh, with King Fahad encouraging other Gulf nations to mend ties with Iran. At the dawn of the American invasion of Iraq in 2003, Saudi Arabia and Iran were significantly closer than they ever were since the revolution. I hope you all enjoyed this episode, and if you like the series, please leave a comment, a thumbs up, and subscribe. In the final episode, we will explore how 9/11 and the 2003 invasion of Iraq came and its implications. Thank you for watching the Thursday Report, and see you all next time.